Festival 12. Can you believe it? I'm with William Ranieri, and we're showing you the wonderful previews that we've done of the exciting week that's been going on. Don't forget that this Sunday, I tell you stories at 4 o'clock at the latest, and I give you tea, all for £6. You don't want to miss this. But the first thing you're going to see today is a delightful interview I had with Frank Finlay.
Okay, I'm here to talk about Screaming Aside, which is a play I'm directing in the Fringe from the 19th of May to the 23rd. It was written by my late brother, Stephen, who was an actor and a writer. And it's about a guy called Stuart Pearce, who describes himself as the Lone Ranger of the IT department. He lives alone and he starts a video diary, a bit like this. He talks to a camera, he makes a video blog. Starts on his birthday. And it moves through important days of the year. So he does Easter and Christmas, but also Shrove Tuesday. He cooks a pancake on stage, which is interesting to rehearse with. And as he does these things, he tells his life story, and he's had quite a difficult life's journey. He's been abused as a child, and he's not really nobody talks to him at work, but he's kind of he's upbeat about it. But as the story unfolds, certain things happen to him, and he makes a decision that he's not going to take it anymore. He can't take it. The screaming inside, the voice in his head, and he embarks on a course of action, which is quite upsetting and tragic. And there's a I won't reveal the ending of it, but it works towards a finale. So it's very intimate piece. It's a one man show, and it's touching. Is the way I would describe it.
I'm Lynn Ruth Miller, and I'm here at ACT, which is Brighton's wonderful, wonderful acting studio for all people who want to be thespians. And we're talking about Screaming Inside, which is a wonderful play and an exciting play, a premiere by Stephen Finlay, who is Frank Finlay's son, and it's directed by Stephen's brother, Daniel. And it's going to be at the Basement, the 19th to the 23rd of May. You don't want to miss it. Don't forget to go to it. And guess who I'm here with? I'm here with Frank Finlay. You all know Frank Finlay. Hi, Frank.
Hello.
Hello. Talk a little bit about what you've been doing and since you started. You started, I think, back in the Stone Age?
Yes, 1952.
Oh, my God. Really?
A long time ago. Yeah.
You were in The Pianist. Everybody saw that.
Yes,
So you were also Iago in Othello.
I was Iago. Yes. I only retired just last year.
Oh, you did retire.
Well, sort of. I've not been working as an actor.
Why have you retired?
I'm too old. I'm too tired, and I'm too good. That was the reply. It was an American actor that said that first, not me.
He's the voiceover in Screaming Inside by his son, Stephen, and directed by Daniel. It's going to be absolutely superb. You don't want to miss it, and you don't want to miss Frank Finlay. And if you go backstage, you'll see him, but you won't see him on stage. I'm the lucky one. And thank you, and don't forget to listen to Festival. We've got a surprise for you. You're going to see Lone Star Cowboys in Brighton. Well, wonders never cease.
I was standing by the window on a cold and cloudy day when I saw the hearse come rolling for.
Hi, we are the Bare Bones Project, and we are doing a play called Lone Star by James McClure at the latest bar for the Brighton Fringe. We are a group of three actors who are also musicians called the Swamptown Boys, and the Swamptown Boys are presenting this play. It's set in the back of a bar in Maynard, Texas, in post-Vietnam America. On this particular night that the play is set, these three men come together, two brothers, one not, and on this particular night, something occurs, a catalyst, who is the other character, enters the life of these two brothers, and their lives are changed. It's about growing up, it's about America after Vietnam, it's about loss, it's funny as well, there are laughs. And at the end of the show, the three actors will do a small set for you of music that grew out of kind of the play that we were doing. So a little bluegrass, a little gospel, a little bluesy. So come and see the play. Also, the boys will be busking around Brighton during the festival, so look out for them.
But I could not hide my sorrow.
We have a talk with Ros Barber about her novel, an interesting speculation about what it would have been like if Christopher Marlowe hadn't been assassinated. You won't want to miss this one.
The question of who really wrote Shakespeare's plays is a controversial one, and Ros Barber has opened the debate again with her new novel, The Marlowe Papers.
Love. If you'd asked me yesterday, I'd say love is a sore that amputates the heart. I'd call it my disease. I'd call it plague. But yesterday, I hadn't heard from you.
Where I've come to with it is that I wouldn't say, oh yes, Marlowe wrote Shakespeare and I can prove it. That's not true at all. You put me out of context and recut that one and then I'm stuffed. But no, what I would say is it's just not as ludicrous as it at first seems.
So call it the weight of light that holds one soul connected to another. Or a tear that falls in all gratitude, becoming sea. Call it the only word that comforts me.
The real talking point about this is you've written a novel in verse. That's particularly what's unique, isn't it? The only authentic voice for Marlowe I know is from the plays, and they're written in iambic pentameter. So I felt like it just felt natural to me that if he was going to write his own story, he would do it in verse.
And at the time, so that's a very contemporary style, really, he was writing it.
Up to the minute, yeah. I mean, now, of course, I'm writing in a style that's 400 years old. But so I wanted to write it in contemporary English and not make it cod Elizabethan, not make it difficult to read or understand for the contemporary reader. I didn't want to make it like Shakespeare in that respect, because people do find Shakespeare difficult.
The sight of your writing has me on the floor. The curve of each letter looped about my heart. And in this ink, the tenor of your voice. And in this ink, the movement of your hand.
You're a poet as well as a novelist.
Yeah.
So do you think, because you've written an awful lot of poetry before, that really came naturally, that was kind of your natural voice?
It's like breathing, really. It's almost hard not to write in iambic pentameter, although I will be writing the next thing I write in prose, but it's very, very easy for me to get into that rhythm.
The book's about to be published on 24th of May, and I believe you have a couple of events in the festival in the Fringe.
I do. I'm in the main festival at the Pavilion Theatre on the 23rd, the day before of publication. Accept as my publisher, and they are 25 this year. Mm-hmm. I'm appearing with Andrew Miller, the author of Pure, the book that won the Costa Book of the Year award. So we'll be talking about our work and reading from it at the Pavilion Theatre. But I've also been invited to do a performance poetry event called Word Jam, which is on the 18th, I believe. I'll be doing some slightly more performancey things, probably.
So two quite different events then.
Two quite different events, yeah, that's in the Fringe.
The Alps now cut their teeth upon the sky, and pressing on to set these granite jaws between us, not a mile will do me harm. Your letter in my coat will keep me warm.
Guy Lloyd's is walking the streets again and asking you to tell him about your most filthy, disgusting, and memorable experience and filth weekends. Be prepared to be shocked and sickened.
We're going up for our Brighton Fringe Comedy Festival in May by finding some filthy weekend stories from the public of Brighton. We want funny stories, filthy stories, any stories from a weekend from your dark and sordid past.
My brother's mate basically was really drunk in a pub, went to the toilet. As he came out, he hadn't quite zipped up his trousers properly, and his penis was hanging out slightly. And he was flirting with a girl the whole time at the bar, he didn't even realise.
We're just asking people if they'd like to share any filthy or funny stories from their deep and dark past.
No.
And ever since he's been called the Thumb, because he had quite a short, stubby penis.
You mean you've got some but you don't want to share?
Yeah.
I remember the opening of the nudist beach.
Excuse me, sir. Can I just ask you, are you sex texting?
No, I'm not. Sorry.
Can I have a look? Can I? You've got proof?
No. Could be, but I'm not. Don't follow me.
The opening of the nudist beach. Wow. How many nudes were there? Was there a lot of nudes? Was everyone into it?
Well, first of all, the ex-mayoress of Brighton uncovered herself.
She got her things out.
That was how it started on the beach.
And for fun bags, I mean, were they good fun bags or?
The good what?
Good fun bags.
What are they?
They're like sort of breasts.
Not sure what you're talking about now.
Yeah, the weekend just gone. It was mine and my girlfriend's first year anniversary. And so I got her flowers and stuff. It's just been my final show. And I thought I deserved a couple of drinks afterwards. So I got drunk. Got home, she was there waiting for me. I was drunk, I'd passed out, woke up, thought I was making my way to the toilet, pissed all over her coat, all over her anniversary flowers. She was not a happy bunny. She got up and left, and then we didn't spend her anniversary together.
Grace Siregar is from Indonesia, and she sings and gives us visuals about what it's like to be a mother. An experience that everybody in every culture understands and can relate to, even daddies these days.
When Rachel, for the first time having a mobile, it was like a two great power meeting each other,
yes.
Children and technology.
Indonesian artist Grace Siregar has an exhibition of her photographs at St. John's Church in Hove as part of this year's Brighton Fringe. I'm going to talk to her about her work.
My solo show explores the mother-daughter relationship amid the tumult of the 21st century information storm.
Grace, tell me about your performance.
It's a Batak song, a song where the mother talking about their children, about love, about worriedness, about the future of the children. Every parents have the same experience that now all the children from the early age have gadgets like mobiles, Kindles. It was like a new experience for me as a parent to see her, how much she engaged with her mobile.
Grace has captured Rachel waking up, and I was lucky enough to wander around the exhibition with Rachel, and she was saying about how literally the first thing she does is reach for her phone in the morning.
Your exhibition's running in the church during May.
Yes.
When can people come and visit it?
It will be on Wednesday from 12 to 5,
mm-hmm.
On Saturdays,
yeah.
From 12 to 5, and on Sunday from 12 to 2.
It's been really beautiful. I feel so privileged to have come and had a real insight into Grace's personal relationship with Rachel. So to money.
And we always save the best for last. It's Vicky's Picks. Our own Vicky Nangle is going to tell you what she loves best about the Brighton Festival Fringe. Be sure to take notes. She has wonderful taste. You'll love everything she recommends.
Welcome to Vic's Picks, my picks of the Fringe and the Festival this year. Kicking off, it's the weekend, and that means time to party. Show starts at 10 o'clock tonight. It's Filthy Weekender Comedy. Tonight and tomorrow night, it's got Nick Helm headlining, as well as a huge amount of support. Well worth checking out over at the Nightingale. Something I would very much recommend going to see is Dip Your Toe Puppet Paramore, as hosted by Boogaloo Stu. Here's one I made earlier. meet up with Stu, he chats with you for 15 minutes and puts together your ideal mate. This is mine, he's stripy, he's got a bit of a cold. But go along, it's only 15 minutes and it costs £4. He's at Churchill Square this weekend. Over at Marina Square at 2 and 3.15 this afternoon is a free festival event, Trolleys. It's a street ballet involving 5 shopping trolleys. It promises to be very good, it's highly acclaimed, and it's free. Don't forget, go check it out. For all of the festival listings and the Fringe listings, as well as our reviews, check out thelatest.co.uk. Have a good weekend.
And I'm Lynn Ruth Miller. I'm going to be telling you stories Sunday at 4. I'm also going to be doing a cabaret called Approaching 80, something I know quite a bit about, May 23rd to 25th. Don't miss it. And thank you again for joining us for Festival 12. Yay!